Hi, I'm Ben-Yaakov. This presentation is entitled The Effect of Switching Frequency on Ferrite Core Losses, The Importance of F times B Peak, and Answer to Riddle. In a previous video, I've posted a riddle that reads like that. Given a transformer, here it is, that is built around the ferrite core and is driven by an AC voltage, here it is, such as the PWM or resonant converters. And the question is, if the frequency of the drive voltage is reduced, frequency of these signals, will the core losses increase or decrease? Notice that the magnetic flux density B will also change. That is, when you change the frequency, the magnetic flux density will change. But I've asked to try to answer in a generic way without resorting to datasheet graphs like this one, from which you can of course see what happens if you reduce the frequency. So the required answer is really without looking at a specific datasheet of a specific ferrite, but rather to get a general answer. So let me start with the losses in a ferrite core, ferrite material. It has been found that the losses can be expressed by this equation, the so-called Steinmetz equation, who was first to suggest this, in fact, template. So here we have the losses in terms of kilowatt per meter cube or millivolt per centimeter cube. This is the losses. F is frequency. Well, sometimes it's in kilohertz, really depends on the constant here. And B is the peak magnetic flux density in Tesla. So this is a very well-known template, which is now used very widely by manufacturers of ferrite material. And what is done is that once the material is made, it is tested for losses, and the data is then fitted to this equation. So these coefficients, these exponential terms, are actually a experimentally fitted value. And then you can actually plot these curves, which are in a log-log scale. And since this is a power equation, it comes out to be a straight line. Now, it's important to realize that although this is very widely used, it is only correct for small signal, sinusoidal small excitation, and also that's correct only for zero DC excitation. So it's rather limited, and quite a number of papers have demonstrated you can improve this expression in different ways, but I'm not going into this issue in this presentation. So here is an example of some data given by vendors, manufacturers of ferrite material. Here is the template. We have it here. This is the Steinmetz equation. Here there is an extension to temperature effect. So it's another correction here. These are also coefficients. This is temperature. And here we have the ferrite material, different materials. This is the frequency range for which the fitting has been done. Now notice that in some cases, like here, there's a different fitting for the two ranges because one fitting does not cover properly or accurately the full range. So you have coefficient for each range. And here we have the constant. This is this constant, and X and Y is what we call earlier alpha and beta. These are the coefficients, and these are the coefficients for the temperature correction. So this is very typical data that vendors are providing. Let me start the answer to the riddle by first considering this product, F times BPK, okay? Now we know that from a Faraday equation that V is N dV dt, this is the flux, and B is the flux density, and they are related by the area, cross-section area, from which we get the delta B, that is from peak to peak, or twice the B peak, is 1 over N A sub E, N is number of turns, A sub B is the cross-section area, and integral from 0 to half the period. That is, I'm taking the integral here. And therefore, in this particular case of, say, a square wave excitation with some duty cycle, we see here the voltage, the excitation voltage or the drive voltage, and we see here the magnetic flux density. So it starts from a lower value, goes to from minus B peak to plus B peak during this duration. Here, because the voltage is zero, there is no change. And then it goes down when we have a negative voltage, and this will continue on like that. So for this particular waveform, we can find that the B peak, which is half the value from peak to peak, is this expression here. This is in fact the integral, because I'm multiplying the fixed voltage here by T on, and this is T on, so this is this, in fact, this is the area or so-called volt second of the excitation. And then I'm replacing T on by D over F, from which, after moving F here to the left side, I find that for this particular case, in which I have already a, say, a transformer, or for that matter, an inductor of a fixed construction, when I change the frequency, F times B PK is constant, okay? So it's not changing. And one can show that the same goes for a sinusoidal excitation, which I'm not going to derive here. So I'm now turning to the reason for the losses, which are the hysteresis loops. Depending on the excitation, you have a minor loop or major loop here, smaller and larger. And intuitively, you'd expect that the losses would be something of this nature. First of all, it'll be linear with frequency, because you are encircling this area a number of times depending on this frequency. And once encircling the area, this means an energy loss. That is, the integral here is energy of B and H, the area. And also, since when you increase the magnetic flux density, you both increase the height and the width of the loop. So it's kind of like B square. So this is like what you'd expect, that the losses will be sort of proportional to frequency and then proportional to B peak square. Now notice that F times B peak is constant. So we can see that the particular case we are discussing, that we have already a transformer, say, already built, then in this case, when you change your frequency, B will change and the losses will be proportional to BPK, because F times BK is constant for the case we are discussing. In reality, the coefficients are not 1 and 2, that is, the actual fitting of the experimental data to the template yields some other coefficient, other numbers. Here is again the, well, it's kind of cut off here, but this is the Steinmetz equation. X and Y are alpha and beta. And here are the coefficient. This is the material. This is a spreadsheet given by Ferrite Cube. You see here the material. You see X and Y. And here we see the numbers. Here it is 2.6x, 2.7, and then it starts 1, 2, 2, 3, 2, 2.5, and then it goes on. Now notice that x, which is the coefficient of the frequency, which I said that intuitively should be something like 1, is not 1, but it is smaller than beta, usually, except for high frequencies, or very high frequencies, like this is 300 kilohertz and up to 400 kilohertz. And then we have also another case here, in this case. In these cases, well, not in here, but in these cases, let's go down here. I have another one here to show. Here we have high frequency. And then again here, we see that only in these very special cases of very high frequency, alpha is larger than beta. That is the coefficient, the exponent of the frequency is larger than that of the magnetic flux density coefficient. In all other cases, you find that alpha is smaller than beta. Okay, so 99.9 probably percent, if not more than that for practical application, you can say that alpha is smaller than beta. Now, if this is the case, alpha is smaller than beta, then I can sort of combine F to the power of alpha plus B peak to the power of alpha, and I'm left with B PK B to the power of beta minus alpha. This is here constant, so this is a constant to the power of alpha. And then I can actually express B peak here as constant over F, okay, from this. So I end up with the following. The approximation of the core losses of a ferrite look like this. It's a constant times 1 over F to the power of beta minus alpha. Now, since alpha is smaller in general than beta for the range up to, say, half a megahertz, and this is for some ferrites, while for most ferrites it's always alpha is smaller than beta, then I find that this coefficient, this is a number which is F to the power of a number larger than 1, which means that as you increase the frequency, the power goes down. Okay, and this is for this case. So the higher the frequency, the lower the losses, or as the riddle was posed, the lower the frequency, the higher the losses. But the total picture is, of course, more complicated if we are talking about the total loss. In this case that we are discussing, the core losses are going down with frequency, but switching losses are going up. Copper losses, that is the wires, the losses of the wire due to the skin effect, the proximity effect, are also going up with frequency. So now the net effect, of course, depends on the numerical values of these, and it could be that the core losses are going down with frequency, but then the increase in copper losses and switching losses are actually larger than what you gain. So it's still worthwhile to work at the lower frequency. So the answer to the riddle is that the core losses are indeed going down, but the general or the total picture could be, of course, different. Now let me add here some information about this product, which turns out that this is a very important parameter. We've seen that for the unit that we have been discussing already constructed, it is constant, that is independent on frequency. But as it turns out, this product plays an important role in other aspects of the magnetic design. So if you look at the AP of the inductor, that is the area product, that is the product of the cross-section of the wires times the cross-section of the core, A sub P, this is the expression from which you can estimate this required value. By the way, there is a video in YouTube in my channel that discusses the design of inductors and transformer by this AP approach. So this is the equation. And since the inductor, say in the buck converter, is inversely proportional to the frequency for the same ripple, that if you keep the ripple constant and you increase the frequency, you can make the inductor smaller. So if you take this into account, you end up with the expression for AP, which has this product here. So this product is really determining the size of the inductor. Same thing goes for a transformer. You have here in the denominator this product. So if this product is high, you can make the transformer smaller for same situation. So this is why vendors are actually providing this type of a graph, in which you have here this product, F type B max. This is now frequency, and these are different materials, and all this is for a given loss, And in this particular case, it's 500 milliwatt per centimeter cube. So what these plots say is that, say for a given material, let's say 3C96, there is a maximum point, which is in fact the optimum point. That is, at this frequency, you get the maximum product F times B max, and therefore, if you build a transformer, say, or inductor around this range with this material, it'll be of minimum size. Now, this material is better, like 3F3 is better in this frequency, while this is in this frequency. So this is a very good insight in how to select a ferrite material for a given application in which you have decided what is the frequency you would like to work at. Now, this is generated for one particular power level or power loss level. And of course, you can generate a curve like this once you know the coefficient that we have mentioned, the Steinmetz coefficient of the equation. You can actually generate it for different power loss situations. So this brings me to the end of this presentation. I hope you found it of interest, and perhaps it will be useful to you in the future. Thank you very much.